walking the beaches of England, June 1940. In this bleak hour, the people of Britain are rallied to defend their island home by their Prime Minister.
We shall fight on beaches, in fields, in streets, and on the hills. We shall never surrender.
1944, across the Channel. The coast of France today, nearly 4 years later. Here, under the Nazi lash, the captive people of Europe fortify the beaches against the tempest of attack gathering across the way in England. Now the Nazis themselves keep a nervous vigil. Along this beach, the tide of history is turning because on dozens of other beaches and distant seas, men have fought and died. Sands of Africa, on the islands of the Pacific, on the once green coasts of Italy. My job as a war correspondent has taken me along with the men who fought some of these campaigns. And I have spoken with many of them.
Did you get in any trouble, Colonel?
No, we didn't have much trouble today.
Find the target all right?
You bet we did.
You did?
Yeah, we really passed it.
When sculptors carve memorials to the heroes of this war, my guess is they will show a man dashing from a landing craft and hitting the beach, just as the doughboy went over the top from a trench in the last war. In this war, wherever we have gone into action, we have first fought for a strip of beach. We are fighting an amphibious war, a battle for the beaches. 4 years ago, our allies lost the last corner of Europe, the beach at Dunkirk. The conqueror rolled his armies to the Channel. Only 20 miles of water lay between the mighty Hitler and final victory. 20 miles an American girl named Gertrude Edley once swam in 15 hours. Surely then, the great dictator could cross this ditch and crush England forever. At Channel ports, he rounded up a collection of barges, fishing smacks, ferries, boats of every kind. His big guns shelled England. The people of Britain braced themselves. They mustered their few guns to guard the beaches. The Royal Navy stood resolute watch in the North Sea. While the fighter pilots of the RAF were writing their page of glory over England, their bomber pilots made daily runs against the invasion coast of Nazi France. The peculiar hazards of amphibious operations baffled the masters of Europe. They decided not to wade out beyond their depth. They wheeled their legions to the east to tackle the Russian bear. For any fight on land seemed a better gamble than fighting from the water. But the seafaring people of Britain undertook amphibious experiments that were to change the course of war. The coasts of Norway and Nazi Europe were stung by prowlers from the sea, by commando raids, daring jabs at Vågsø and the Lofoten Islands, rehearsals, importance of the mass invasions to come. Across the earth, the other enemy, Japan, no longer held in check after Pearl Harbor, carried out its plan of empire, ran amok among the islands, pillaged the Pacific down to the very coast of Australia. As America squared off for the fight, our Navy faced a challenge to carry armies across the seas and disembark them, not in some protected harbor, but directly upon the beaches of the enemy, under fire.
We must move a strong force from ship to shore against fortifications. Between dark and dawn, armored divisions must be beached against opposition. What will it take?
What will it take? It took plenty. New weapons, landing craft. Since 1936, some of these craft had been developed by the Navy. Others were the result of British secrets learned from commando experience. The builders took over the blueprints. The workers rolled up their sleeves and pledged themselves to lay it on the line, pronto. Materials and parts and motors flowed together from every corner of the land. By new methods, keels and frames were assembled, made sturdy enough to withstand the shock of hitting the beach that always before had meant shipwreck to mariners. At prairie plants and coastal yards, the ugly ducklings began to hatch, ready to carry invasion. Men, too, were getting ready to hit the beach from landing craft. Soldiers are land fighters, but many now learn to fight from the surf. A man worth his freight to the beach must be a specialist, must do his own particular job on the fighting team. Every branch of every service is welded into the cutting edge of an amphibious striking force. At the same time, in the Pacific, our fleet was scoring triumphs at Midway and Kula Gulf, in the Coral Sea, and at Cape Esperance, whittled down the enemy and tore openings for the great amphibious assaults to come. When an amphibious operation starts from a base, the transports are combat loaded. Every man, every weapon is logged aboard according to fighting plan, set to come off the ship and go into action in the order needed on the combat shore. The invasion fleet is screened by escort vessels. An aircraft carrier shields them with an umbrella of planes. As the convoy approaches the theater of operations, a sharp lookout is kept for enemy planes. Our fighter planes take off to bring down an enemy snooper detected trailing the convoy and out of range of our guns. The Jap plane is caught, tries to crash our carrier deck. Reach the rendezvous area, the task force commander and the shore fighting general analyze conditions, adjust their plans, and freeze them. They pass the word down the line.
Rendezvous at 0350. Keep your boats well closed up till you approach the line of departure 4,000 yards offshore. You've got to cross that line at 0512. Naval barrage and air support.
The carriers launch their planes to cover the operation. The assault troops get themselves ready. The small landing craft, the LCPs, are lowered away to circle until they take aboard the raider parties, which will hit the beach first. The naval barrage begins, softening up enemy shore installations as at Guadalcanal, at Bougainville in November 1943, and at Tarawa a few weeks later. From the air, our flying guns destroyed Jap planes on the ground and knocked them out of the sky. Meantime, our first wave of landing craft is proceeding full speed towards the shore. As they come within range, they begin to run the gauntlet of enemy fire. There are are no foxholes offshore. The assault wave hits the beach, crosses the beach, digs in, and holds. This boy and his rifle are at this moment the spear point of America. Only through the inches and yards of beach these men win can we funnel more men and equipment to expand the attack. Offshore, under fire, the transports are unloading guns and howitzers to be carried in the next attack wave by the middleweight landing craft. They hit the beach along with the amphibious craft, which the boys call the alligator, the duck, and the water buffalo. The enemy is pressed back further, burned out of his caves and pillboxes. Now we hold the strip of beach and can organize it to pass supplies inland to the firing lines. The bulldozer comes ashore to handle heavy utility work. CBs and engineers lay a wire road for wheeled vehicles. Ahead, the assault waves are devouring ammunition. The area we control is now mopped up and prisoners are brought in. The team is tied together by communications. The beachmaster relays the requirements of the shore commander to the waiting ships. Tank lighters drop their ramps and out rolls the heavy stuff. The bow of a tank landing ship, the LST, opens wide like Jonah's good whale, and the steel shapes of war ride into battle to deliver the heavyweight wallop which will win the objective. We took the Aleutians. We took the islands of the Pacific from Guadalcanal to the Marshalls. By fighting with sheer heart, we blasted the enemy, crumpled his walls, and we have many new airfields. Thus, as we grow stronger in weapons for this new kind of war, we will land on other islands and on other shores. The shrine on Tarawa is still tonight. The silence of the Jap dead warns the masters of Nippon that American fighters ride the sea to battle for the beaches of Japan. Wherever the waves break on an Axis beach, the enemy has come to fear our power to invade. The attack against Germany began when we took a continent, Africa, because our landings were on a scale beyond anything the Axis powers themselves could match over water. From our great African base, we attacked Sicily. Our bombs ruined the harbors, bottled up the ships, cut off supplies from the mainland. Our airborne troops floated down to block the roads. A great fleet of invasion craft, many of them infantry landing craft, LCIs, shuttled across the Mediterranean and landed their men. The cracked divisions which defended the island collapsed. With Sicily in our hands, we landed large forces on the heel and toe of Italy. An amphibious fleet headed up the coast, bypassing miles of enemy coastline, and struck at Salerno deep in enemy territory. As I stood on the beach at Salerno, I marveled at the individual efforts of so many soldiers and sailors could be organized and woven into a pattern of war effective enough to push through that curtain of hellfire the entrenched enemy was sending against us. But Italy itself was no mere island like Sicily to be taken in one blow. For the first time, we had met the enemy on his own home base. Wherever we landed, we had to battle our way ashore. His planes took off from the backlots of Naples and Rome. But But even though we paid the attacker's price, we were able to bring to bear from the sea enough strength to dislodge the enemy. We forced him northward up the Italian peninsula. While the enemy is engaged on the land front, our amphibious force can be used against the coasts, can leapfrog behind him, and surprise him as we did later at Nettuno. When we freed the Italian people and demonstrated our ability to land on enemy coasts in greater strength, we came to a turning point in the war. At Cairo, we resolved to hurl our amphibious power against barbarous Japan. At Tehran, we determined to destroy the German armies. To do so, we must first invade the coasts of Europe. The Nazi armies reeled backward under the blows of our Soviet allies. The bombers of America and England are writing the prologue to Germany's eventual destruction. The hour strikes when Germany may be knocked out by invading fortress Europe. The curtain rises. Now it is our turn to stand on an English beach poised for invasion. We have no illusions about the perils and costs of such an undertaking. We remember the ship loaded with urgent cargo going up in fireworks at Salerno. The precious gasoline nursed halfway around the world only to burn in a jungle at Bougainville. And the sad, the bitter cost in life. The wounded floating from Tarawa. The man newly blinded at Salamaua. And those who fell forever, everywhere.
I am the resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live.
These German-made pictures are the Nazi version of the raid against Dieppe, France, in August 1942. They are shown to Americans for the first time as a measuring stick of the cost of amphibious war. He says, the German troops right there guarding the coast were enough to take on the English and Americans, and they smashed them without extra help. Here you can see the aftermath of the fighting I watched at dawn from a British destroyer standing by offshore. Although important objectives were achieved, a critical loss was in landing craft. The cost of the raid and casualties was high. These brave men of ours are now prisoners of the Nazis.
Transportern und drei Frachtern. Und weiter nördlich eine Gruppe von 26 Transportern als operative Reserve.
This heavy investment at Dieppe taught us lessons that will make our coming attack pay off a thousandfold.
Das Leben in Dieppe zeigte schon wenige Stunden später wieder sein normales Bild.
He says the Nazis mean to keep Dieppe normal. They mean to keep us from returning to Dieppe or any place in their fortress, Europe. On the rim of the continent, they have piled up fortifications, concealing giant guns. These we must storm. Behind them are railroads and highways to rush supplies wherever we may breach the fortress wall. On the enemy's beaches, we need many things. We must build a tremendous array of landing craft, enough to carry an invasion greater by far than any we have ever staged. This, then, is our challenge. To build a bridge of landing craft to reach the beaches of the enemy, wherever he may be. For across that bridge lies our victory.
Mm-hmm.